we've come together tonight to celebrate Black history and culture and to highlight the vital work of Trust for Public Land to preserve sites nationwide that speak to our history and tell the story of Black life in America. We have some inspiring speakers tonight, including co-founder of Uncle Nearest and Black History and Culture Advisory Chair, Keith Weaver, as well as President and CEO of Trust for Public Land, Ms. Diane Regas. And finally, public historian and nationwide director of Black History and Culture for Trust for Public Land, Dr. Jocelyn Imani. It's gonna be a wonderful night. And if you did not know who Trust for Public Land was before you came into this place, I promise you, when you leave this place, you will never forget. Now, we are going to have great food, as you probably have already tasted, great drinks, and great entertainment. But now I would like you to help me welcome to the stage our first speakers, okay, come through, all right. I'm going to introduce to you somebody who's extremely special. You may know him as the co-founder of Uncle Nearest, and now there's two of them, so the co-founders of Uncle Nearest. Some of you may know him as the Humble Baron. Some of you may know him for his shoe game because it is so, so clean. I would like to introduce to you two of the most special individuals that you will ever meet. And many people don't know this about Keith, how amazing he really is. Like, they don't know. He lets it be undetected until it's absolutely necessary. And his counterpart, she's like the complete flip opposite. You know exactly who she is from the moment that she walks onto the stage. Please help me welcome Mr. and Mrs. Keith and Fawn Weaver.
Christy Joy, you're amazing. So she's this talented, and we're actually related. That's my sister in love, Christy Joy, who's next under Fawn. But I want to introduce Fawn Weaver in a manner that she so deserves. She's my love, she's my life, she's my heart. For us, we co-founded this company, but she leads everything that you see and touch. The reason why Uncle Nearest is the fastest growing whiskey or bourbon company in the world is that she's the quarterback of that strategy. And she's cute. but she's just amazing, and I just love you so much. The way we're in this space is actually inspired by her. So she's a creative genius as well. She came up with Humble Baron as a tribute to me. And yes, I executed a lot of different things, but thank you, I love you.
I love you.
So tell him, welcome.
Well, here's the funny thing, is I was supposed to be introducing him so that he could welcome y'all, and so now I'm completely confused as to what we're supposed to be doing.
Welcome.
Yeah. Welcome to our home. Thank you for being here. The grounds that you are on, you may or may not know this, but it's as close to the Holy Grail as you're going to get. And let me tell you what I mean by that. Christy Joy said this is the world's longest bar. This isn't by accident that it's the world's longest bar. We determined by the Guinness Book of World Records who's the world's longest bar and how long it was, and then we decided to beat it by 100 feet. That's what you're sitting in, is the Guinness Book of World Record, the world's longest bar. The distillery that you are at, when we opened this distillery, it was the first time in history that any distillery had been named after commemorating an African American hard stop. The distillery that you are now on, that you are standing in, we're only technically two years old since we opened this. And by the end of this year, we will be one of the top five most visited distilleries in the world. And by the end of, our goal was the end of 2026, but it'll really be by the end of 2024, based on our pace, we will be one of the top three most visited distilleries in the world. I say all that to say that you are sitting amongst Black excellence, on Black excellence, on Black excellence. The general manager here is Black. The executive chef, the sous chef, Black. The head of the beverage program, Black. We have 13 leaders here at Nears Green Distillery. 9 are Black, 1 is Puerto Rican, 1 is Asian.
He's a DeBarge,
but he's still Puerto Rican. We did not set out to have the most diverse leadership in the industry. We did one thing and one thing only, is to decide to hire the best of the best of the best for every position, and that's why you're sitting here today. And that's it. Welcome.
So I love how she said, "I don't know why I'm here. What will I say?" And then she does that. She does it all the time. So my part is simple. One, why the Trust for Public Land? And I'll just be very transparent. What compelled me about the Trust for Public Land's work is their work on urban parks initially, in which is to take very urban dense areas that are populated with people of color and create areas and opportunities for people to play and experience trees, grass, and joy. So that was the start years ago. And then it evolved to open space and very much evolved into this work that we're now leading and we'll learn a little bit more about today, which is the Black history and culture work that we're doing, and it's amazing. I won't get ahead of it because we're gonna talk about it more. But that's really what inspired my involvement and why we're closing on a Friday night. Whew.
Y'all, let me say this. This is the first and only time we will be closed for a private event.
Fair.
On a Friday night, because those doors, there is a line there and a line there at exactly 5 p.m. Yeah. When we open. There's not an open seat in the house.
Yeah.
And to close it down on a Friday night, I want y'all to know is exceptional.
It's crazy.
It's nuts.
But we love it. All right, cool. So around this bar, it's a tenth of a mile long. It's crazy. There's 3,048 glasses here to populate the world's longest bar. So it's pretty great. But I do have some thank yous. And I'm gonna refer to my notes so I don't forget anybody in particular.
That's a lot of notes.
Well, it's just because.
Okay.
All right, you can leave now. Bye. Bye. No, you don't have to leave. Come here. So I will start with the 1772 Foundation. Where are you, Mary Anthony? Your board's here. So, very early supporter, lead giver. It's amazing because to be a seed funder and start things moving in a material way is important. So I know Mary is here, the executive director, board members are here. We had a good meeting this morning, so want to applaud them. Thank you. Next, I know a little bit about this next, I don't need a note for this company, Sony Pictures Entertainment. So my side hustle is I'm an entertainment executive, and I have been for 21 years at Sony Pictures Entertainment. So we fueled this work as well. I've got things I'm incubated so that that will sustain beyond the initial gift. So we will see how that goes. I'm working on that. The National Parks Foundation, one on the partnership on the Nicodemus site, which you'll hear more about, Forks of the Road, and the Medgar and Merle Evers Home Monument, which is huge. You'll hear more about that later. And I want to make sure we lift up TPL supporters Martha Wyckoff and Terry Tome for their kickoff gift for this work. Thank you. The Black History and Culture Advisory Council. I see my peeps here and around the room. Thank you for how you show up and you flew out here for our meeting today. We had a great meeting today. It was awesome and unveiling all this stuff. It's really wonderful. The TPL National Board. I see Lucas, our national chair, is here, and other board members from across the country, Tom, others, great. And the Georgia and Tennessee Advisory Boards. I want to make sure those of you who've come out here are applauded as well. Thank you for the projects you're fueling in and what you're doing in your respective states. And then last, there are a lot of high-level people. We don't like to say VIPs here, but certainly we want to applaud our legislative champions here in Tennessee, the Black Caucus in the Tennessee Legislature, other Tennessee legislators, city council members from Nashville, planning committee. There's a whole group of you who care about this work and have shown up, and it's really wonderful. And then the last person that I will thank and introduce is Diane Regas. And so Diane, she's our president and CEO of the Trust for Public Land. And I will introduce her, but I will start with a thank you. So Diane called me and told me about this idea, this concept to fuel Black history and cultural sites in this country, which TPL has done this work for years. But her intentionality about the call, her investment in the work, her care and concern was extraordinary. And normally, I say no to everything. I'm nice, but I say no. And I'm trying to get off of things, and I say no. It's been progress.
It's progress.
It's progress. But Diane did that, and she does so much more. So I'm really, really honored to introduce my friend and our leader. You will see her come up after a video that shows, but I don't want to miss anything about her phenomenal background. So I will refer to these notes so I don't miss anything. She's led the Trust for Public Land into a whole new era, true. And we've doubled down on our commitment to creating equitable parks, public lands, and sites that honor history and culture, particularly Black, Indigenous, and communities of color sites in this country. She previously served as a top civil servant working to preserve our nation's vital natural resources under two presidents and has spent decades fighting for climate action. Please welcome my friend and TPL president and CEO, Diane Regas, to the stage after a short video.
Well, welcome to each of you, and please join me first in thanking Keith and Fawn for hosting such an incredible, beautiful event. Keith, Fawn, thank you. The way you have shared and honored the story of Nearest Green gives me so much hope and excitement about the future of this movement to honor Black Americans. Keith, it was in conversation with you, and I give you more credit than you all just heard. That was really the inspiration for the possibilities of this work and became clear in that memorable conversation. Your leadership, Keith, has brought us here today, and I am deeply grateful for everything you've done and for your support for the Trust for Public Land. So for those of you I haven't met yet tonight, I hope I do get to meet you. I am Diane Regas. I'm the president and CEO of the Trust for Public Land. And so for many of you, it's our first time meeting, so I'm just gonna take a second and share a little bit about who the Trust for Public Land is. We are a national nonprofit, and throughout our 50 years,
We have been working to ensure that all Americans are represented in and connected to our important public spaces as a matter of health, as a matter of equity, and a matter of justice. We create public land, we protect public land in places where they are needed most. We work in partnership with communities to help them come up with their dreams and help them figure out how to achieve them. We work on communities' vision for parks and public spaces. Why? We do this because land has meaning. Let me say that again, because it's really important. Land has meaning. Places tell our story, and they connect us to the truth, and they connect us to each other. When you think about an organization focused on the outdoors, you might imagine that we work on big places like Yosemite or Zion National Parks, and you'd be right. We have expanded those parks, those national parks, for all of us. But you should also think about neighborhood parks and the hundreds of places that we've transformed from hot asphalt lots into vibrant green spaces for kids and families in Brooklyn, in Queens, in Newark, in Oakland, in Los Angeles, in Atlanta. And you should think about the childhood home of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., where we purchased more than a dozen properties over a 30-year time span to help preserve the neighborhood as Dr. King would have known it when he was growing up there. Or you should think about Nat Turner Park, which is a gathering space we built in Newark, New Jersey. It's named for the enslaved preacher who led one of the most important uprisings in American history. It's now the largest city park in Newark. So tonight, we are here to share and celebrate this aspect of the Trust for Public Lands work, our longtime work to celebrate and lift up Black history and culture. So I want to share a little bit about why this work is personal to me. And when I was a kid in Colorado, and I know there are others here from Colorado, I was privileged to grow up in a multicultural community. The joy of different cultures celebrated in my community center, in my church, in my school, in parties, was formative for me. But when I looked around at the landscape of my community, I didn't see that diversity. Now, as a kid growing up in the West, it might not surprise you that my heroes were cowboys and mountaineers and smoke jumpers, and there were parks across Colorado celebrating those people. But when I looked at those places, here's what I did not see. The stories of Black cowboys, the settlements, those were not there. Those communities had largely vanished from the Colorado landscape, to say nothing of our collective consciousness. Yet, you may not know that one in four cowboys was Black. There were 25 Black freedmen settlements in Colorado alone, and even more in Kansas. Now, apart from one in Kansas, Nicodemus, and we have a Nicodemus descendant here in the room. Where are you? Over there she is. So Nicodemus was one of those freedmen settlements, and it's the only one left. The others are remembered only in a scant few history books and in the stories of their descendants. And I wonder what would it be like if those homes, those community halls, those settlements were still there. They could have illuminated my childhood. They could have illuminated millions of others with the stories of courage, resilience, and the fight for freedom. So the erasure of Black history and culture across my home state is not unique. In fact, in my decades of work in conservation, it has been persistent and it is prevalent. This is an amazing statistic. of the more than 100,000 sites on the National Register of Historic Places, just 3% recognize Black experience in this country. Just 3%. And that is why we are here tonight, to make room to end this disparity by adding Black history and culture places to our landscape. We are also here to bear witness to the urgency of this work. There are aging giants of the civil rights and Black radical movements in the sunset of their lives. There are sites of enormous importance that are decaying and crumbling right before our eyes. And most disturbingly today, there is a deliberate political and sometimes a violent effort to deny and erase voices and stories of Black experience from churches, from libraries, from school curriculums, and even from the legislature here in Tennessee. It is our mission at the Trust for Public Land to serve as an antidote to this erasure. We do this by embracing the whole truth. As complicated and as uncomfortable as that can be for some, we are committed to reflecting that full experience in the landscapes that we hold so dear. We do this by reaching out, supporting, investing, listening, and working with communities to create and build places that matter to millions and millions of people. And when we get that right, it allows the full human experience, the pain, the courage, the joy, the hope, the full human experience to burst forth. So tonight, Keith Weaver, who you met, and Dr. Jocelyn Amani will take the stage in a conversation about these special places. Jocelyn uniquely combines a deep understanding of the past and a fierce urgency for now. So you, I know, will enjoy hearing from the two of them. So she and Keith are going to share why it's imperative to preserve these important places and what we all stand to gain by honoring the full story of America through this work. And by the end of the night, I know you will be eager to join us in this important effort. Thank you.
So what you are seeing here is what TPL has been doing, which is creating a place to belong. You guys ever heard that saying, there's no place like home? TPL is creating homecomings all over the United States. Yeah, you can clap that up. So now I'm gonna bring to the stage to talk more about what they've done, what they're currently doing, and why so many have decided to invest. I'm gonna bring Keith Weaver back to the stage. I'm also gonna bring Dr. Jocelyn Amani, who, by the way, like, this is her baby. What you're seeing right now, her being the nationwide director of Black History and Culture for TPL. She is a whole vibe. And then they're gonna be met by Mrs. Mickey Woodard. She's going to be moderating this fireside chat. Come on, Miss Mickey. And Mickey Woodard, she has a lot of accolades, a long list, if you might know. But one thing that you may not know is that she's the granddaughter of a Tuskegee Airman. It's near and dear to her heart, and this is a part of her legacy that she really wants to highlight and leave behind. So we're so happy to have you moderating. All right, so please give another round of applause to these amazing individuals.
Nat Turner Park, I said, this must be Nathaniel Turner, a local civil rights leader in Newark, New Jersey. This can't be Nat Turner from Virginia. And it is. That is one of my favorite examples of the work that we lead at the Trust for Public Land, because that community in Newark, New Jersey advocated for that park for 20 years. 20 years, the project rose and fell and rose and fell, and they called in the Trust for Public Land, and we came in and raised the money and led the participatory design process and created a park that reflected the needs and wants of that community. And now it is the largest park in Newark City inventory, servicing 19,000 residents. and it's named in the name of Nat Turner, and children and community members play and congregate. So that's the work. As you see, we still have, there's some gaps in the map. There's some gaps, and as a historian, I know that there's African-American stories all up and through where those gaps are. There's black folks in Omaha and Colorado, you know, all up and through. So we're working on it. We're working on it.
Thank you. I love it. It's good. It's really good. So Keith.
That's me.
That's you. So earlier, Diane talked about embracing the whole truth.
Yes.
And earlier today, Keith, you talked about being the steward of this story. So the history and story of Nearest Green is central to this brand, Uncle Nearest.
Absolutely.
And the way that you and Fawn have honored and shared this journey has been a labor of love.
Yeah.
Talk to us about this journey. Talk to us about the importance of preserving Black history and cultural sites.
That's big. That's a big question. So for us, we feel like this work that we're doing, we're stewards of Uncle Nearest and his legacy. We're stewards of even in creating a highly successful spirits company, which will soon be a spirits conglomerate. We feel like we are stewards of something that, but for a number of events, could have been lost again. So what's important to know is Jack Daniel, the person, was very deliberate and intentional about lifting up and recognizing Nathan Nearest Green. But the story had been part of Lynchburg life for a while. It rose, fallen. I don't know how many times, honey, you know all the details. I give Cliff notes and they're kind of gloss overs, and she's a person that has every particular fact. But it was the type of thing that without this work could have been lost. Probably would have been lost, except for a series of events. And so as it connects to the brand, we recognize that Black leadership and ownership matters. We recognize being an independent matters. We also recognize that in that stewardship, the goal of the company, as Fawn often says, and I have come to agree with, I'm just gonna be transparent, it wasn't always on this page, because it's like, okay, we'll just sell this thing for however much we'll make, is we're not to profit from it personally. 200 years from now, the point of what we're doing here with Uncle Nearest is that you will know Jack as you often do, as you always do, and Johnny and Jim Beam and all of those, along with Uncle Nearest. That's the point of everything that we're doing. There is no exit plan, so for all of my banker friends in the room, not Jonathan from JP Morgan, he's not a banker. but that's the purpose of what we're doing, because what's happened with all of this work in less than 6 years, this summer will mark the 6 year anniversary of Uncle Nearest Premium Whiskey. All of this work, I guess what I want to say is this, is that when we started the work, we weren't trying to start a whiskey company. We were trying to lift up, preserve, amplify an amazing American story, at the center of which is someone who was a pioneer, which is both Nearest, obviously, but also Jack. It's like one of the earliest cases of allyship, and it's remarkable. From here, Middle South Tennessee, from that farm, for all of those on the council we were at earlier, and in the middle of the Civil War, right? And so this is very purpose-driven work, And it relates very much to the work we're doing at TPL. So, but for the fact that Fawn and I own the Dan Call Farm, which is where Uncle Nearest or Nathan Nearest Green lived, where he taught Jack Daniel how to make whiskey, where Jack Daniel himself lived, and then after we bought the property in 2016, we learned that it's the site of the original Old Number 7 distillery. Any number of things could have happened to that property. In fact, the house looked like a hot mess. It was renovated in the 70s. Shag carpet, cottage cheese, panel over stuff, on top of a house that was 150 plus years old. It's crazy. Others were looking at that property for rick houses, which for those of you who don't know, that's industry term of art for warehouses that store whiskey barrels, rick house. That's for free, you get to. But it just fuels not only the stewardship thing that I've spoken to, but everything else with the brand. And when I think about TPL's work and what we're doing together, it's really amazing that there's so many stories. Yeah. We were talking earlier about how, yes, there are these stories that we know, and your family in particular have lifted up these, but there's so many more. What else do we not know, right? And so this, what we're investing in, and the last thing I'll say, I'm sorry for being so long-winded, but the last thing I'll say is that the reason for this convening is that this kind of work, unlike other types of social justice work, where it's pretty clear, mass incarceration, you get that. Policing policy, you understand that. There is an elevator pitch for everything. It is not necessarily the case for the work that we're doing nationally. So we have to tighten it. I've managed to get it down to 4 minutes, but that's people's eyes glaze over. I lose Fawn in 3 minutes.
but
2 minutes, right, exactly. So it's really, really critical, and it undergirds actually where we are. This would be, but for the fact that it's privately held, this site would be a site that we'd be protecting 50, 100 years from now. So it's special.
I was talking to Fawn about the tour, second time I toured the site today, and I noticed something different. And we were on a part of the tour where we were in a really sacred area, really learning about the history of the property, and I had missed the names etched in the floorboard. And I had missed the fact that they squeak on purpose, so that their sound and voice continues to reverberate in this work.
Yeah, right.
It's incredible. So, you talk about stories, you talk about intention. There are so many stories. When you showed that map, and as you pointed out, there's a whole gap in the middle. But tell me just a couple.
Okay.
Just a couple of your favorite stories. And speak to the urgency that we should all feel about preserving those stories.
Sure. if you want to know more, see me afterward, because I could talk about this all day, but I won't. So one that I'm really, really beyond excited, I'm honored to share, is the Clemens Family Farm. My advisory council members heard me talk about this earlier. It is a black farm in Charlotte. I've been saying Charlotte, it's Charlotte, Vermont. And if you think about, when you think about Vermont, that doesn't really seem like a place where black people have a lot of farms. And it's not. It's only one of 17 in the state, black-owned farms in the state. There's a couple, the Clemens family, that created this farm in 1962. It's 128 acres. The couple is now 99 and 100 years old. They had made this, the husband was one of, if not the first, black professors at the University of Vermont, one of the first. And, you know, it gets to a point, if you think about how everybody's family is, mom and dad are getting up in age. Some of the kids want to sell the land to take care of mom and dad. Some of the kids want to keep the land. So one of the kids made a nonprofit and wanted for the nonprofit to buy the land from the family to preserve it in perpetuity. Well, they were a bit short, right? There's a question about how much is the land worth, and even if we get it appraised right, will we have the money to do it? When they first came to the Trust for Public Land, there was no role for us. There was nothing we could do. But by God's grace, we were able to help this last go round. And I'll leave the numbers not for the stage, but we were able to make a significant gift to help them complete the transfer of land on the eve of the father's 100th birthday. Yeah. And now I am planning to go there Mother's Day weekend, and I'm taking my mama, y'all. But when I asked the daughter about, you know, how are the parents doing? Can I talk to these folks? At 99 and 100, there's good days, bad days. Because I really want to know, why did you make this farm? Why, you know, it's a retreat space. If you look, they have a website, Clemmons, C-L-E-M-M-O-N-S, Family Farm. I want to talk to them and get their story. But again, at 99 and 100, good days, bad days. What can we do? Similarly, I mentioned Megra Merle Evers National Historic Site in Jackson, Mississippi. Miss Merle Evers is still alive. And we think she's gonna join us possibly at this commemoration in June. But that was 60 years ago. She watched her husband be murdered in her driveway 60 years ago. And it's still traumatic, it's still difficult. And I should mention with Clemmons Family Farm, I've gotten permission to mention it on this stage, but our team, we're probably not gonna see a press release from us about this because there's a genuine concern about the response from white supremacist domestic terrorists, right? Like there's a legitimate fear of safety. And there's a similar, you know, the same thing with Ms. Murley. Can she go back to this site? It's very traumatic. And to be able to get these stories from the people who live them while they're yet living, while they're coherent and conscious enough to be able to tell the story of how they made it over, we have just a little bit of time. So I'll stop there. But it's important. We're running out of time.
Those were great. Thank you. Keith, I'm going to ask you the same question, but I'm actually going to combine it. Okay? Tell us your top stories. Tell us why there should be a sense of urgency, but then tell us why this room should invest and support this work.
So good. So much. So I will be very transparent in telling this story. So sorry. Actually, I'm not sorry. I'm just gonna be very transparent. So I didn't get this work. Because this work, as I mentioned, it takes, as I mentioned, 4 minutes to get to why it matters. And I decided to go to one of the sites that we're working on in Natchez, Mississippi. My Mississippian folks are here. And in so doing, and in part, it was because it was Forks of the Road in Natchez, which was the second largest slave trade port in the country during slavery, and it's already quote unquote protected. So I'm like, well, the work is done. There's a plaque there. What are we doing? And I go to Alcorn University. The president of Alcorn is here, Dr. Nave. About 10 minutes from there is a site. Also adjacent to that is where Oprah Winfrey lived as a child. And when I go there, I see a really pitiful plaque, and around it are signs of development to come. And as we're there, I'm with Shane Hooper, who's our head of economic development for this region. As I'm there, we're looking, we're learning, we're seeing, and I said pitiful already, it's pitiful. And as we're standing there, experiencing the site, imagining what transpired during slavery, all the people poured it through the space, traffic through the space. A truck pulls up. It's a redneck truck. I could spot a redneck truck. I haven't lived in the South long, but I could see it.
And as a you know a redneck truck when you see it.
I know a redneck truck when I see it. And I'm like, oh no, what's about to happen now? And the guy pops out, this white guy, I don't know, unfair, but I'm just gonna own it, redneck looking guy, but oh crap, not the word I wanna use, but I'm just keeping it wherever. And then his wife or whatever comes out, and the kids come out. And so they're walking towards us, and I'm thinking, are they like, yay, slavery, like, let's go see where it all happened, or what is it? And so through that, as we're looking through the little pitiful thing that's there, we start conversation. And what I think about is the additional investment needed to make sure that the tire shop across the street and the transmission place and the temple beyond us, that that inspires thought, education, conversation, opportunity in a material, real way. And but for the work we're doing to come alongside even that site that's protected is very necessary so that we can imagine what this learning opportunity is and we can grow from it. But without it, there's very little funds put into this work because, as I said earlier, there are very obvious things that you would think about investing in, not necessarily this. But much like your house, if you imagine that, if you don't put any money into it, if you don't paint it, if you don't call out termite control, if you don't fix the roof, at some point it's gonna fall apart. At some point it will be dust. At some point, people won't remember the shutters you had on your house. This work is very analogous to that. And that's why it's so critical, and that's why we care, and that's why we did this crazy thing in closing this bar. This bar makes a lot of money, by the way. We closed this bar on Friday for free, okay. I'll get over it. But so that's why this matters, is that. And I could go, I mean, Connecticut, where Martin Luther King first found his calling to become a reverend, and also where he first saw a desegregated society was there in the summers while he was a student, inspired the people, the person that we know and often talk about, right, Dr. Carson? So I think all of those things tell me and tell us why we're grounded in this work, why it matters, why we've convened you, why I want to make sure I'm deliberate in thanking those who've invested, and why we invite others to do the same.
It's a strong case for investment for certain. All right, lightning round. Last question, fifth question, here we go. So we're in this beautiful room. We're thinking about the past. And we're investing in the future.
Yes.
Jocelyn and Keith, starting with you.
Yes.
Tell us about the future you want to see.
Can you put the map back on? Put the map back up. So number one, I want more dots on this map. There are more places, there are more stories. There's an African-American presence throughout the totality of this country. And we need to be able to understand that, to understand our shared American history, our shared American past. Number two, for the sites that are on that map, we need them stewarded better. Did you know there's about 100,000 individual sites on the National Register of Historic Places? Only 3% of them tell a black story. Three. And we built this country. So we need to have more sites. Number two, the sites that we have need to be protected, stewarded, and in better condition. And three, I want public land to help black people live better lives. Period.
And Keith, as you tell us about the future, for anyone in here that is interested in investing, what should they do?
Oh, okay, I love this. All right, so not that that's a prompt at all. However, bam,
yes!
I got it right here. So One, just to piggyback on Dr. Imani and what she just said, what I love, particularly for us leading a company where we're first, biggest, major, fastest, we don't take great pride in that. When we look at who's number two, the second fastest growing spirits company that's Black-led, there's a big gap. We don't necessarily like that. it's not something that gives us joy. When I think about our experience in this country, I don't want to be the first. I want to know about Nicodemus. I want to know that we thrive before us because it happens to relate to what actually happened. So with that, yes, I will take my prompt. And before I even go into this part, I really earnestly want to thank you for the time that you spent with us to learn more. People have traveled from across the country to be here with us this evening, and I'm very honored that you did so to learn. But if you're so led, if you're so compelled, there are two different ways. One, you can give right now, which is you have two things in front of you. One, this little cool round disc, and it's very tech, at least to me, maybe not to you all, where you can scan this and give in this very moment. For others who are thinking about how you might consider giving, but not sure because that requires thought. I mean, we're all gonna die and you all have probably estates and stuff like that. What are you gonna do with it when you're dead? You might as well fuel this work. Is that wrong? We are gonna die, it's factual. So you can fill this out and you can talk to people in the future, or Pat is over there, she's ready. She's been checking your pulse as you walk in to make sure.
Oh my God.
Feeling sick? Anyway, sorry. I'm want to support a good. Sorry.
And the contact card is also if you just want to stay in touch with us.
Yeah, absolutely.
If you want to know more about this work.
Okay, fine. Bring me back.
Yes.
Whatever.
Because we want to know how you got here, how you found out about
right,
it.
Right,
we're
right.
Gearing up. This is a kickoff. We are launching, we're revving up, so we want to stay in touch with you. So yeah.
Absolutely, absolutely. So thank you all, and this isn't it. So I believe if you're at a bar, yeah, we can learn at a bar. We actually have Gospel Sunday brunch at a bar, so people got saved at a bar, which is so crazy.
Jesus drank some wine.
Jesus is in a bar. So, but we're gonna have fun tonight.
Shall, and will.
We're gonna have fun.
I'm ready for the fun, but I actually want to end. When you were talking, a scripture came to mind, or just a phrase, to whom much is given, much is required.
Spider-Man? Oh. Jesus or Spider-Man? I don't know. Both.
This is the time, and we are deeply grateful to everyone that has traveled here to not just invest, but also to expose, to be intentional, to learn. And Dr. Imani, we are grateful for your leadership.
Yes, thank you. Awesome.
Keith, we are grateful for your sacrifice.
Oh, thank you.
And I hope everyone gets another one of those drinks that is shaken, not stirred.
Oh, goodness.
We also want you, if you enjoyed yourself tonight, tell a friend.
Yes, please.
Tell a friend. Share the good news about what we're doing.
Oh. I'm going to do this part.
Oh, okay. Wait. Fawn is back here. Oh, no.
Yeah.
Uh-oh. She got something to say. She's not on the agenda, folks.
Well, come on, Miss.
She's got a mic.
All right.
I'm going rogue. Oh. Mickey asked the question, and I was like, okay, I'm going to come do the other half of it for my husband. So hang tight.
Come on, Mrs. Weaver.
All right.
Come on, Mrs. Weaver.
You guys can leave now. You can leave. Everybody can
I am not the fundraising appeal kind of person. It's simply not my thing. However, I do think that there is something that is important and that there is an urgency to this work. And the reason I say there's an urgency is when we came to Lynchburg in 2016 and began to look into the story of Nearest Green. Nearest Green's eldest descendant, his granddaughter, was still alive. I interviewed her at the age of 108. Jack Daniel's eldest descendant, who helped me to actually take the photo of Nearest Green's grandchildren and Nearest Green's descendants that were living, didn't know who was who. The photos were not, the people were not written on the photos. It's Jack Daniel's eldest descendant that said, that's Cousin Jesse, that's Cousin Eddie, that's Cousin Ott. Every person who I interviewed, after I interviewed them, for the most part, went home to be with Jesus. They held on long enough to tell the story to the people that they knew would preserve the story. There is an urgency because when you see in America, and this is, I'm going to talk not to the black folk for a second. I'm going to talk to everybody who's not us. When you see a rise that happens and you start to hear this murmur of, well, this country is better than the country that you came from. And you start to hear that a lot. And there's an argument, both sides, but it doesn't matter. The reason why you see every single time something happens and African Americans, you see this rise. How many people in here know someone who was adopted or you adopted someone? Raise your hand if you know someone who's been adopted. No matter how amazing the adopted parents are, at some point, that adopted child has to find their own parent. It doesn't matter that the parent was on drugs. It doesn't matter that the parent gave them up. In order for that person to feel who they are, to understand who they are, to really know how they became who they need to find their roots. African Americans don't have roots. We weren't given that option. We were pulled from our country. We were put in another country. It doesn't matter how amazing America is, and believe you me, I am currently on a CEO tour in which I am visiting military bases around the country for 4 months straight simply to say thank you. This has nothing to do with patriotism. I'm about the most patriotic person you're going to meet, but I understand my ancestors were not given a choice. We were put here, we were severed from our roots, which means that if we cannot create roots here, we will always look for our birth mother. So for every person who has the money to give, before this generation begins to die with what only they know, give what you can so that we can begin to build our roots in this country. That's it.